is Dr. Javier García Oliver. I'm a senior lecturer in law at the University of Manchester, and this is part of the wider project Balancing Belief, for which I've been working with my colleague Dr. Helen Hall at Nottingham Trent University for the last few years. And today I'm going to focus on the UK Parliament, but particularly the lower house, the House of Commons. And on another occasion, I'll also be discussing with you the composition and the functions of the upper house, the House of Lords. Let's start with the House of Commons because it's the strongest house, it's the most powerful house, and it should be the strongest house because it's elected by us. It's composed of 650 members, and they are elected according to the first past the post voting system. According to the system, the winner takes it all, and the candidate who gets one more vote than the second candidate will return the seat. Hypothetically speaking, this person could only have a 25% of the votes of that constituency, but he or she will still get the vote, the seat, my apologies. Then, basically, of course, it has significant strengths. It's a system that produces a strong government, but is not necessarily, in many ways, proportional. And this is something which has been heavily discussed and criticized in many quarters. Who are the most important members of the House of Commons? Obviously, it goes without saying, the MPs, 650 representing their constituencies. But I think it's quite important also to refer to the role of other important figures in the lower house. And first of all, let's focus on the Speaker. The Speaker of the House of Commons is meant to be a neutral figure. He or she comes from a political system, such as a political party, such as it happens with the current speaker, who is conservative, John Bercow. But when he is carrying out his task as the Speaker of the House of Commons, he is meant to be neutral. The members of the House of Commons are going to be divided into two main categories, frontbenchers and backbenchers. And frontbenchers are those MPs who, at the same time, also hold a ministerial responsibility, either in cabinet or in the wider government. In other words, even though sometimes people tend to think that junior ministers who do not sit in cabinet are not frontbenchers, that is an error, that is a mistake. They are also frontbenchers. And who are the backbenchers? All the remaining MPs. Those MPs who do not hold a ministerial responsibility. But of course, it's very, very important for the government to make sure that those backbenchers vote in compliance with, according to, the wishes of the government. Or we also have exactly the same model in the opposition government, in the shadow government, that is the way it's called. Then who is going to be in charge of making sure that the backbenchers are following the party line? Well, there is a very interesting figure, very controversial, debatable. Some people, some commentators argue that it's a clear challenge to democracy, and this role is carried out by the so-called whips. The House of Commons is the stronger house, as I mentioned in the beginning of this video, and there are two important instruments which guarantee the primacy of the House of Commons over the House of Lords. And they are the Parliament Acts 1911 and 1949, and also the Salisbury Convention, according to which, as we shall see, the House of Lords is not going to oppose legislation which was contained in the manifesto of the political party which is in the government. Many thanks.